Hi, welcome to Big Data Analytics tutorial. In this video, I will discuss important concepts related to Hadoop Distributed File System, that is HDFS. They are safe mode, rack awareness, high name node availability, name node federation, checkpoint and backup, snapshots. We will start our discussion with safe mode. What is HDFS? Safe mode. HDFS safe mode is a maintenance mode. Whenever a name node starts or restarts, it enters into a read-only mode that is called a safe mode. In this mode, blocks cannot be added, replicated, or deleted into a data node. Now, why safe node is required? The data on name node is stored on primary memory or non-persistent storage. Because the data is stored on non-persistent storage or a primary memory, whenever a name node restarts, the data stored on the name node will be deleted. So if the data is deleted from name node, how the name node serve the request of the clients? To make sure that the name node serves the request of a client, the name node should know where a block of information is written on data nodes. So whenever a name node restarts, the HDFS goes into a safe mode. In safe mode, there are two possible cases. So what happens in safe mode is the previous file system state of the HDFS cluster is reconstructed by loading FS image file into the memory. That is, FS image file will be loaded into the name node so that the previous file system state can be reconstructed. Also, the edit logs after writing the content into FS image, if any modifications were done to data nodes, that log will be applied to the FS image to get the up-to-date file system state. So that is the first thing happens. The second thing is the mapping between the blocks and the data nodes is created by waiting for the data nodes to send the block information in the form of heartbeat signals. So what happens is whenever a block of information is written into data nodes, that information should be replicated or it should be written into name node so that whenever a client makes a request, the name node knows where the block of information is written on data node. So that's the reason in safe mode, the name node waits for the data nodes to send the block information so that it can create the metadata information on its memory. So these are the two things happens in safe mode. So the first thing is it will reconstruct the file system state by loading FS image and reapplying the edit logs. And in safe mode, the name node waits for the data nodes to send the block information so that it can reconstruct the metadata information. So these are the two things happens in HDFS safe mode. Now there is another possibility. Whenever a name node restarts, it will automatically enters into a safe mode and these two things happens. But there is another possibility, that is, the administrator can enter into a safe mode manually for some reason. For example, there is a need of maintenance, or there is a need of, there is an issue related to file system. Those things need to be addressed. In such case, the administrator can enter into a safe mode manually by using a command called as HDFS DFS minus safe mode. So whenever this particular command is executed, the HDFS cluster will enter into HDFS safe mode, where the administrator can do some corrections or configurations to the HDFS cluster. So HDFS safe mode is the HDFS cluster will enter into HDFS safe mode whenever a name node restarts. That's the one possibility. The another possibility is whenever there is a need of maintenance or there is an issue related to file system, the administrator can enter into a safe mode manually by issuing a command called HDFS DFS admin minus safe mode. The next concept is rack awareness. So when it comes to HDFS cluster, HDFS cluster has mainly three components. The first component is a single name node, one optional secondary name node, and multiple number of data nodes. Now, because there are multiple number of data nodes, there is a possibility of arranging these data nodes into different ways. Like we can arrange all the data nodes into one group, and then we can say that one as a rack. So in the first example, there were six data nodes are there. All the six data nodes were put into one rack. In the second example, there were three data nodes are there in the first rack, and the remaining three data nodes are put into another rack. So there are two groups of data nodes are available in this case. In the third example, the available six data nodes are divided into three groups. In each group, two data nodes are put. So there are three racks in this case. Now, what is rack awareness? Rack awareness is nothing but which deals with something called as a data locality. So what is data locality is, if the data is available on the local machine, then definitely the performance of the system will be best in that case. Why? Because if all the information is available at the same place, the for processing the request, it will be quite fast. So that is the reason if the data is available on the local machine, definitely the performance of the system will be fast. Now, there are three possible cases in this case. The first case is the data resides on the local machine. So that is, in the previous example, all the data resides on one data node. If that is the case, what happens is the performance of the system will be best. In that case, the performance will be best, but it suffers from a single point of failure. So what is that? All the data is available on the same machine. In that case, the client request can be served at the faster rate. That is, the performance will be best in that case. But it suffers from a single point of failure. That is, if that local machine or the machine which has the data failed, the entire information will be lost. So that is the problem with respect to the first case. The second one is the data resides on the same rack. That is, the data is divided into blocks, and that data will be put into the same rack. For example, in this case, in the first example only, the block of information is stored into one data node, another block of information is stored onto sixth node. So in that case, what happens? If this particular data node is not working, in that case, this particular data node, you can access at least a part of data from sixth data node. If it is not working, a part of data is available on the first data node. So we will be able to access at least a part of data whenever a data is distributed on the same rack, but not on the same machine. So in this case, there will be a better performance. I cannot say that the best performance we can achieve. We can achieve a better performance that is somewhat less than the best performance, because we need to access the data from two machines to get the final result. So that is the reason we will be getting a better performance. But it again suffers from the single point of failure. So what is that in this case is, let us say that if data node 1 fails, a part of data is available on 6th node. If a 6th data node fails, a part of data is available on the 1st node. But if this particular rack fails, that is, all the data nodes are connected to single switch, if this switch is not working, so in that case, we will not be able to access the data in this case also. So there will be a better performance in the second case, but there will be a again single point of failure in the second case also. So what is the third possibility? The third possibility is the data is divided into a block of blocks, and that particular block of information is put on different racks. For example, we can put we can divide the block of information. First block of information will be put into data node 1. Second group of or a block of information is put into sixth data node. Now let us say that what will be the performance in this case, because the data has to be accessed from two data nodes and two different racks, two different racks. It is not present on the same rack also. So definitely the performance will be less than the second case also. So we can say that the performance will be good in this case. We cannot say best or better. It will be next level, that is the good level. But what about the failure? In this case, because it is present on two different racks, if one data node fails, the data is available on the second data node. I cannot say entire data, but at least part of data is available. If the second data node fails, that is this one, the part of information is available here. The another level is, if this particular rack is not working, still we will be able to access the data from the second rack, and if this rack is not working, we will be able to access data from this particular node. So that is what the advantage of having the third case. But the problem with third case is what? We will not be able to achieve the highest performance. We will be able to achieve the least performance compared to three possible cases. Now, to avoid that particular single point of failure, name node, or can say that the HDFS cluster, what it does is it will replicate that particular data blocks on multiple racks so that it can improve the it can achieve the improved fault tolerance. That is, if the data is present on different racks, definitely there will be a good performance. But if all the racks are not working, in that case also there will be the possibility that we will not be able to access the data. To avoid that, what name node does is it will divide that particular data into different blocks, and then it will be copied on different racks. That's the first case. And what it does is it will replicate that particular data blocks on multiple racks, so that if any of the rack is not working, still the complete data is available on the another rack. So that is the case. Now, this is what actually happens if the entire rack at the final stage, you can say that if entire rack failed, definitely we will not be able to access the data. In that case, HDFS will be in a it will stop working. So that is what the case. But if one rack fails, definitely we will be able to access the data because it was replicated on different racks. Now, when it comes to default Hadoop installation, there will be what we can say that all the data nodes are belongs to the same rack. So that is what the default Hadoop installation. If you want the data nodes on multiple rack, we need to configure it according to our requirement. So this is about rack awareness. The next concept is something called as name node high availability. So why it is necessary? That is, we have already seen there are three components. One is name node, secondary name node, and multiple data nodes. So in a default Hadoop installation, there will be single name node. Now, if because there is a single name node, if this name node fails, what happens? The entire cluster will fail. That is the reason we need to have some mechanism so that if a name node fails, still we should be able to do our task on the cluster. I'll take one simple example to understand this concept again. Let us say that we have one name node and 100 data nodes are available, and there is one secondary name node. Let us say that all 100 data nodes are working perfectly fine. There is no issue with all 100 data nodes, but the single name node fails because of some reasons. Let us say that there was a power fluctuation, or the memory in the name node got corrupted. For some reason, the name node is not working. In such case, still all the data nodes are working fine. I will not be able to use this particular cluster. The very simple reason is the name node is not working in this case. Now, how to avoid this particular thing? To avoid this particular thing, there is another way of installing it. There is something called as we can create name node high availability Hadoop cluster. So what it means is, rather than having a single name node, we can have multiple number of name nodes. So that is what is called name node high availability Hadoop cluster. But in this case, we will not be having all name nodes are working at the same stage. Only one name node will be in an active state, and the remaining all name nodes are in standby mode. They will not be in an active state. They are in a standby mode. Now, each and every name node, it may be an active name node or it may be a standby name node, every name node is configured with exactly the same software in this case. Now, as I said earlier, there will be one name node which is in active state, and remaining all are in the standby state. Now, if that particular name node fails, that's the active name node fails, the one of the standby name node can take the responsibility of active name node, and then it can work as a active name node. In such case, the Hadoop cluster will be active. We will be able to use the Hadoop cluster without any problem in that case. So that is the main reason behind using multiple number of name nodes in this case. What happens here is to guarantee, let us say that to guarantee that the secondary standby name node has the exact information of what is available on the active name node. That is, whenever an active name node fails, the second standby name node becomes the active name node. So what should happen here is there should be some guarantee that the standby name node has the same information what is available on the active name node. So because of that, whenever a block of information is written into data node, the block reports will be sent to active node, active name node, as well as to the standby name node, so that there will be a same information available on both the name nodes, that is active and standby name node. So we can understand that thing with a very simple diagram here. We can see there are two name nodes are there. One is an active name node, another one is a standby name node. These are the data nodes, and there are something called as a journal nodes. I will come to these journal nodes later. Now, whenever a client wants to do some operation, let us say that operation, or you can say that a task, he will request that particular task to active name node. He will make a request to write some data into data nodes, or he wants to client wants to read some data from data nodes. So whenever a client makes a request to read some data data from data nodes, the active name node will give the data node addresses where the block of information is available. The client can read the data from data nodes. Whenever a client wants to write some data into a data node, again he will make request to active name node. So when he make a when a client makes a request to active name node, the first the active name node calculates how many number of blocks are necessary to write the data, and accordingly it will allocate some data nodes to write data to the client. So client will write the data into this data blocks, and those data block reports will be updated in active name node. So the same information will be updated into standby name node also. So the task, or you can say that everything is controlled by active name node, but whatever the information is written into active name node, the same information is available over here, that is in standby name node also. And one more thing is, whenever the client is doing some operation, there will be lot of information stored into active name node. That information should also be copied into standby name node, because whenever this active name node fails, this will become an active name node. So whatever the information is written along with the block reports, it should also be written into standby name node. So because of that, there are three journal nodes are used. By default, in any HDFS high availability cluster design, three journal nodes are used. You can use more number of journal nodes according to your requirement, but minimum requirement is three journal nodes. The reason behind using three journal nodes is this cluster may be used by n number of clusters, and there will be lot of updation will be happening in active name node. So those updation cannot be handled by a single journal node. So there should be more than one journal node. So in default case, there will be three journal nodes. So whatever the updation happens in name node, it will be updated in journal node. That will be in turn written into standby name node. So this is how actually the HDFS high availability design looks like. So in this case, there will be an active name node and there will be a standby name node. Whenever an active name node fails, the standby name node takes the responsibility of active name node, and it will work as the active name node for the Hadoop cluster in that case. So what is the procedure? The active name node sends the file system edits to the quorum of journal nodes. The quorum of journal nodes, it then sends that information to the standby name node. Now the next thing is there is one possible case. Let us say that, as I said earlier, there is one active name node and there will be multiple number of standby name nodes. Now when we have multiple number of standby name node, when a main, or you can say that an active name node, fails, so one of the standby name node has to take the responsibility of active name node. The question is, which one will take? For example, there are three standby name nodes are available. If the active name node fails, who will become the active name node out of possible three standby name nodes? So in such case, Apache Zookeeper will come into picture. What it does is, Apache Zookeeper is used to monitor the name node health, that is the active name node health. If the active name node health is perfect, if it is working fine, Apache Zookeeper will not do anything. If the active name node is not working fine or it has got failed, then Apache Zookeeper will select one of the standby name node as the active name node, and it will allocate all the responsibilities of active name node to that standby name node. So that is the responsibility of Apache Zookeeper in this case. So this is how actually the name node high availability design works. In a name node high availability design, there will be an active name node and there will be multiple number of standby name nodes, so that whenever the active name node fails, the one of the available standby name node takes the responsibility of active name node. Now the next concept here is name node federation. So what is name node federation then? So what happens here is, we have a single name node and multiple number of data nodes. So when I say multiple number of data nodes, the number may be 100, or it may be 1000, or it may be 10,000, or any number. So in a earlier HDFS installation, there will be a single name node, and it will the single name node stores the namespace of entire cluster. Entire cluster's namespace, or the information, will be maintained by single namespace, and it will be stored into single name node. Now what is the problem? As and when you go on increasing the cluster size, if you go on adding the data nodes into the cluster, what happens is, the information to the name node may not, in a name node it may not be possible to store entire information. That is, whenever you go on increasing the number of data nodes into the cluster, it may not be possible to store the information into a single name node. Now what is the problem? That is the one problem. There is a one more problem. There is a one, that is, if you have too much of information into a same name node, the performance you may not get the best performance, because whenever a client makes a request, you need to find the required information from huge amount of data on the name node. So that is a problem. So what is the first problem? It may not be possible to store entire cluster information into a single name node. If you are able to store also, that will become a huge data. Because of that, whenever a client makes request, it may be a read request or write request, the name node may not be able to give the best performance, because it has to search the required information of the client and then it has to serve that particular client. So it will take definitely more time in that case. So to avoid that thing, what happens in name node federation is, there will be multiple number of name nodes. So when I say multiple number of name nodes, it is not like high availability name node design. In high availability name node design, there will be multiple number of name nodes, but there will be only one active name node, and remaining all are standby name nodes. When I say name node multiple number of name nodes in name node federation, all the name nodes are active in this case. If I say two name nodes are there in name node federation, both the name nodes are working perfectly fine in this case. Now when I use this multiple number of name nodes, what are the advantages? The first thing is namespace scalability. If you go, as and when the number of data nodes are increased in the cluster, we can add the number of name nodes, so that we can maintain the information of the cluster very easily. That is the first thing. Second thing is better performance. if I store all the information into one machine, definitely it takes a lot of time to search for the information. Rather than if you divide that particular information into multiple number of name nodes, it is easy to serve the read and write requests of the client. The third advantage is system isolation. That is, if you have multiple number of name nodes and you are the cluster is serving multiple number of projects, let us say that two projects. So project one can be assigned to name node 1, project 2 can be assigned to name node 2. In such case, the clients associated with project 1 will contact name node 1, and the clients associated with project 2 will contact name node 2. So that is the advantage of having multiple number of name nodes. So that can be shown something like this. In this example, there are two name nodes are there, name node 1 and name node 2. Data node 1, data node 2 and 3 are the three data nodes. So the first thing is, as and when the number of data nodes in the cluster increases, we can go on increasing the number of name nodes. That is the first advantage. Because two name nodes are there, a part of information is stored here and the another part of information is stored here. Whenever a read and write request came from a client, it is easy to get the data related to that particular client. And the third advantage is isolation of projects. If this particular cluster, the name node federation cluster, is serving two projects, this name node can be allocated to project 1 and this name node can be allocated to project 2. So whenever a client makes a request to name node 1, definitely he is asking or he is interested in project 1. Whenever a client makes a request to name node 2, he is interested in project 2 or something like that. So that is how actually it works. This is the intention of adding multiple number of name nodes. So don't get confused with the name node federation and high availability name node. In high availability name node, there will be multiple number of name nodes, but there will be one active name node and remaining all are standby name nodes. In a name node federation setup, multiple number of name nodes acts as the active name nodes. There will not be anything called as a standby name node in this case. The next concept in HDFS is checkpoints and backups. So we have already discussed this thing in safe mode. So whenever we can say that name node fails or name node restarts, not fails, it restarts, all the information stored on the name node will be lost. So what should happen here is, whenever it restarts, all the information should be retrieved from FSImage, and then the file system state should be reconstructed. So to do that, we need to have a checkpoints. So what actually checkpoints does is, checkpoints is nothing but the secondary name node. It will continuously read the information from the name node and it will be stored into FSImage file. Whenever a name node restarts, this FSImage file will be reloaded into name node, so that it will get the file state will be reconstructed in the name node. That is what the checkpoint is all about. The second thing is backup. Now what is backup? Backup is something like, it is almost similar to checkpoints. The only difference between the checkpoint and backup is, there is nothing called as a secondary name node. There will be this file system state of a name node will be stored into the hard disk, or you can say that a secondary storage. Continuously that information will be stored into hard disk. So using that particular thing, what we can do is we can reconstruct the system state of name node. So that is what the advantage. Now these two things, that is checkpoints and backups, are done automatically. That is checkpoints whenever they will be continuously running behind the scene. That is, whenever there is a modification or updation to the name node, the entire information will be copied into secondary name node, or it will be copied into a backup file, so that whenever a name node restarts, that information can be used to reconstruct the file system state of a name node. Now any one can be used. You can use the checkpoints, that is the secondary name node. If there is no secondary name node, you can use the backup file. You can store that particular thing into one file called as a backup file, and whenever a name node restarts, you can use that particular backup file. So this is what actually the concept related to HDFS checkpoints and backups. Now the last concept related to HDFS is something called snapshot. Now what is snapshot? Again, snapshots are similar to backups. They are not something different than the backups. Whenever there is a name node restarts, the name node file name node state should be reconstructed. So there is a need of what we can say that a backup. We can use backups or checkpoints. There is another possibility, that is snapshots. Now, compared to backups and checkpoints, snapshots are done, or can say they are created by the administrators. So what is the meaning of this one is, checkpoints and backups are automatically done behind the scene. That is, they will be continuously running behind in the background, and those will be, it is not required to create them manually. But snapshots are created manually by the administrator using a command called as HDFS DFS minus snapshot. Whenever administrator executes this particular command, a backup will be created. It will not be done automatically in the background. It will be created, that is a snapshot will be created only when administrator executes HDFS DFS minus snapshot command. So now there is one more advantage with respect to HDFS snapshot. When it comes to backups or checkpoints, entire file system will be entire file state information is stored into those checkpoints or the backup file. But when it comes to snapshots, you can create a backup of entire file system. That is the one possibility. Another possibility is you can create this backup of subtree of a file system. For example, you have a directory structure. If you want to take the backup of entire file system, that is possible. If you want to take only a part of that particular file system's backup, that is also possible. The second thing is, snapshot can be used for data backup, protection against user errors, and disaster recovery. Snapshot creation is instantaneous, but it is not done automatically. Compared to backups and checkpoints. So whenever you whenever administrator issues HDFS DFS minus snapshot command, the snapshot will be created instantaneously. And blocks on the data nodes are not copied. Whatever the information available on the data node is not copied into the snapshot. What is there in the snapshot is, it records only the block list. How many blocks of information is available on data nodes? That is available in snapshot. And what is the size of each block? So whenever the name node restarts, only it needs where the block is present, what is the size of that particular block. So it stores only that information. It will not store the data or the actual data present on the data node. It stores only how many blocks are there and where it is stored and what is the size of that particular block. So whenever a name node restarts, it can use this particular information to reconstruct the status of that particular name node. So this is what actually the concept related to HDFS snapshot. So in this video, I have discussed HDFS safe mode, HDFS rack awareness, HDFS high name node availability, HDFS checkpoints and backups. And finally, I have discussed HDFS snapshots. I hope the concept is clear. If you like the video, do share with your friends. Subscribe for the channel for regular more videos you can see. And press the bell icon for regular updates. Thank you for watching.